what 20 years as a PJ is, I feel like I've lived about 10 lifetimes. My personal experience over the 20 years has been very positive. I've had a pretty robust career. I've gotten lucky. I've had a lot of time stationed in rescue units, like here at Moody Air Force Base. I've had almost half of my career stationed in AFSOC. I've spent a tour overseas. I've had 7 deployments. All total, I've probably got close to 5 years, so a quarter of my career is spent in a deployed location or overseas. So I've had a really, really good, really positive experience. What a pararescueman does is mainly focused around personnel recovery. And so most of our training and effort goes into preparation and accomplishing that goal. It's special because, you know, we trust each other maybe a little more than I'd say a normal working environment would, because we got to trust that guy that he's looking for the right stuff and he's setting us up for success, because, you know, if they potentially miss something, it could potentially be our lives. A lot of times I'm not thinking about the end goal. I'm just thinking about, you know, how my foot position is going to be in the door. And when I jump out, how should my body position be? My hand, where I put it on the other guy's rig, is that going to interfere with his emergency system? How can I mitigate that risk? That's really all I'm thinking about. Can't burn the candle from both ends for 20 years at least. It just doesn't work that way. So we got to make it a point sometimes too. When we see guys working too hard or the team driving too hard, we'll have to make it a point to set time aside where the movement is slow and they have time to sit back and bring their families out, let them see what we're doing, get the families involved like you saw today. It's hugely important. It took a lot for me to succeed, to be a PJ, and it took a lot to stay with it because it's hard to grind, but I'm very happy that I did. The end result, I don't have any regrets. I wouldn't have changed anything at this point in my life. Going back, if I had to make all the same choices, I would have. Not a lot of people can say that, so I consider myself very lucky.
Our motto in the rescue community is, these things we do so that others may live.
The mission for the HH-60 is very diverse. Our main mission is combat search and rescue or personnel recovery, but we can also do hurricane relief duties, CASVAC, medevac, and we can also do civil SAR. I am Staff Sergeant Kaylee Jones, and I am with the 66th Rescue Squadron, and I am a Special Missions Aviator. A Special Missions Aviator is a fairly new career field, and it's a combination of an aerial gunner and a flight engineer into one AFSC. What we do is we are systems experts, so we need to understand the helicopter, all the components within it. That way we can help the pilots evaluate and analyze the situation and come to a logical conclusion. This is a very physically demanding job, but above that is very mentally exhausting. So you have to be able to bounce back all the time. And as far as me overcoming them, you know, I study a lot and I work out a lot and I hang out and rest when I need to. The thing that excites me the most about my mission is probably shooting the 50 caliber machine gun. Obviously, that's a lot of fun to do, but I think the most important and rewarding part of my job is the fact that we train so much, and even though it seems redundant, it's fulfilling to know that we get a call that a downed pilot has gone behind enemy lines and know that I'm able to do my job and do it well to go in and pick up the survivor. So when I sit in that seat, I'm looking out, scanning, or I'm employing the weapon, for me, that there's nothing that beats that. That, for me, is my dream come true. It's what I've been wanting to do my whole life.
To save lives. I feel like us as the 79th RGS, the maintainers, we work really hard, always on the shift. Someone's there to make sure that these aircraft are ready, prepared, and to launch them out into the air to get them where they need to be.
We work around the clock. 24/7 to make sure these planes are good to go at the drop of a hat. So whenever we get tasked for a personal recovery or a rescue mission, we can get our supplies, load onto a plane, and send it off and do its mission.
We make sure that our pilots are confident that the aircraft they're taking is going to be able to help them accomplish the mission they need to.
There's times where we get alerted to a real-world situation. We generate an aircraft and help refuel a helicopter so the rescue man can go and save the individual.
79th RGS is rescue. That's our primary duty, and that's what we do. We do a little refueling, but that's all in the service of the rescue mission. Our specialties for the aircraft are being able to do those long-range rescue missions where the aircraft isn't really a problem. Now we're just focusing on how long the aircrew can last because of our high fuel capabilities. You know, I feel like the 79th really contributes to that greater mission with rescue and providing that support to our people who are in the most dangerous fields. We're able to provide them that security that even if they're in some very big trouble, that they have someone here back home and in field that can support and help them and will be looking for them when they think they're not being searched for.
With all the small elements that we continually train on and practice and just gain more proficiency with, this massive CSAR event allows us to combine all those tiny elements that we've practiced individually into a larger operation. Particularly with the 306th, we all play by the same playbook, we follow the same rules, and so we all know how to do the job we're assigned to do. Integrating with any type of live element on the ground just adds another element of realism to what we do. We integrated with a number of different units outside of our squadron to ensure that we can do what we train to do, which is rescuing a simulated personnel who is behind enemy lines. I was the down pilot. I had a bad back and couldn't feel my legs. The 306th had to essentially treat me, throw me on a stretcher, and throw me back in the helicopter. Oh. It definitely follows the practice like you play mantra to ensure that we're actually training for the actual mission. We can meet the combat search and rescue needs of the Air Force overall and of the combatant commanders that require a search and rescue element to their theater.
Where our setup has been.
We have this primary being the HSC running the dual water integration with the secondary mission in phase two.
Surprise bar will go out and it's going to be a. And then once it's in the water though, that Fred's device will kind of hold it a little bit so that once we get into the water, we can then pull it fast. Easy though, that fast roll. Super smooth, and as soon as the last swimmer
This exercise started within the rescue group here on Davis-Monthan. The rescue forces at large determined that they needed deeper levels of tactical training than some of the large force exercises of the world were able to provide at the time. The focus and the desired learning was different. They started this exercise to provide their own venue for this training. It established itself as an emerging center of excellence for combat search and rescue and personnel recovery. And that drew in partners from across the joint force, as well as partner nations and allies. As it grew, it eventually needed to refocus itself. The higher powers within the Air Force determined that it should become part of the exercise enterprise, which is when we were created as Detachment 1 to the 414th Combat Training Squadron based at Nellis, who runs the Red Flag that everybody knows and loves today. Red Flag Rescue supports DM in being the home of rescue and attack. There is no exercise anywhere in the world like this that exclusively focuses on the combat search and rescue and personnel recovery environment. While many others dabble, they imitate, we are meeting the end state vision of denying the adversary its opportunity to capture and exploit the aviators of the world. Our allies and our partners and our joint force are ready to go downrange confidently that rescue has their back, and we will bring everyone home, whatever it takes. Rescue happens anywhere in the world, any time of day, in any kind of environment. This gives our combat aviation the chance to evolve in a somewhat safer environment. When we go downrange as integrated force packages, a rescue triad, a lead wing, we are already synchronized before we even hit that first sortie in theater.
We provide the players with a variety of challenges in their scenarios. It can be something as simple as a pre-planned exercise. We have Jack on the ground. He bailed out yesterday. We need you to go get him. But we also have scenarios like, hey, you're planning to cover this strike package, but we're going to surprise another mass casualty event that happened. We need something you can pick up a lot more people that you plan to support. We have long-term survivors out there that they've been kind of following all week, but they don't know where they are, and they're going to pop up at probably the most inopportune moment. And it makes the players form decisions on how they're going to get everybody home, or even if they can get everybody home, and makes them think critically about why we do what we do and how we do it. The biggest way that this prepares them for real world scenarios is it teaches them how to work with other players. In our everyday training, we show up, we fly with the same people, and this gives everyone the opportunity to bring in other assets that they don't normally get to participate with, learn what they bring to the fight. We can start the process of figuring out how we can make our system operate in an environment where we maybe can't talk to each other. The training they get here, they're not going to see anywhere else. It's really an opportunity to take what the lessons learned here and spread it to the home units and let them start that conversation. How do we improve rescue? How do we prepare for the next fight?